Hello, everyone, and welcome to episode 252 of the RRBG podcast. This podcast is a proud member of the Podbelly Network. Go to podbelly.com and check out all the amazing shows we have on our network, including the Sofa King podcast, Robots for Eyes, Art and Jacob Do America. I mean, there's one for everything that you're into. If you're into Magic the Gathering, they got you. If you're into the occult, they got you. You're into serial killers, they got you. Everything. Go to podbelly.com, check out the list, and support the network. This episode is also brought to you by Killcliff. My friends over at Killcliff make the best energy drink you can buy in the market today. Clean energy, none of that crap that they put in Monster or any of those Red Bulls. No sugar, just clean power for all the grind you're going to have to put in today. And if you're not grinding today and you just want to relax, they also have CBD drinks to help you recover from any injuries you may have, any kind of inflammation. Maybe you went a little too hard at the gym. CBD drink will get you right back on track. Go to their website, killcliff.com. Check out all their different flavors. My personal favorite Ignite drink is the Cherry Limeade. And in the CBD category, you have to try the Joe Rogan special. It's the Flaming Joe Pineapple with Jalapeno. It's not that spicy. You just get a little bit of a kick at the end. It's delicious. Go to killcliff.com and tell them that RRBG sent you. This podcast is also brought to you by Saints Joints. Go to saintsjoints.com and check out all the awesome products they have there, including the new Book of Saints that comes with four packs of pre-rolled joints. It's this incredible, lavish, luxurious-looking gold foil stash box. The works. It's the best-looking stash box I've seen. Make sure to go pick one up before they're all gone. And also check out the new hash-infused pre-rolls. Don't forget, it's saintsjoints.com, and make sure you tell them that we sent you. In this episode, it's the return of Gavin Hayes from Dredg. We caught up to see how he's been doing during the pandemic. We talk a lot about music. Dredg has a lot of stuff coming. He mentioned that there's a Leitmotif reissue coming. They're also working on something special for El Cielo's 20th anniversary. They're working on a new album, and they've got almost two albums worth of material. We talked a little bit about society and social media. We talked about what inspires him and how he writes. It was a great conversation, and I hope you guys enjoy it. Follow the band at Dredg the Band, and if you get a chance, check out our Patreon page. Go to patreon.com/RRBG and support the podcast. Cheers. What's up, everyone? Welcome to the RRBG podcast. I'm here with Gavin Hayes of Dredg. How are you, brother?
I'm doing well. Thanks for having me.
Welcome back to the show. Yeah, welcome back. It's been a long time. I didn't even realize how long it's been. I was looking through my old episodes to like, let me listen back, make sure I don't ask the same questions.
Yeah. And if you do, I don't remember. So a little redundancy might be okay.
And yeah, it's like episode 51 or two, I believe it was, and I'm at like 240 something now. So it's been a few years.
Yeah.
Last time we spoke,
pre-pandemic, I guess then, right?
Oh yeah. Yeah. I wasn't doing video pre-pandemic. It was funny. It was all audio. And now I've been going back, like, who did I talk to that wasn't on video? I want you on video now.
Right on.
So how have you been? How have you been this, you know, we were just talking before we started recording, but how have you been during the pandemic?
Not bad. I mean, I've been kind of a hermit a little bit and actually have been enjoying aspects of that.
Okay.
You know, I work another job as well, and I've had the luxury of being able to do that for my house. So, I don't miss having to commute. I don't miss being in an office. So, you know, it's, I think for a lot of people, it's just kind of a, everyone's in the routine of the past couple of years of, you know, whatever that routine may be for someone. I mean, it's feels like I'm in a groove, but you know, it could be better, but I'm not complaining. I mean, you know,
sure.
Everyone in my family's healthy, and I, you know, I've been lucky enough to be healthy as well. So
that's good. That's good. Yeah. Working from home has been so nice, and you know, I also have a day job, and now they're talking about the return to the office, and I'm just like, why do we have to do that? We're working just as well. Like, nothing has changed for you in terms of product, you know, quality and consistency or whatnot. So I don't know. I hope a lot of companies start to reanalyze and, you know, kind of reassess what they're working with, because it's unnecessary to have like all this, you know, a whole building with an entire floor of cubicles. Like, you don't need that. People could just do it from home. You know, you just got to set some boundaries. Yeah.
Yeah. I was even thinking that prior to all this, right? Like, if I ever ran a company that needed an office, which will probably never happen, but I was thinking, you know, you lease or buy an office that's maybe half the capacity of your employee headcount, and you can kind of alternate days, and it just seemed logical, right? And I think companies now, they must be, at least from a business standpoint, like electrical bills, a lot of these companies provide food, all these things, right? Just, you know, getting people out of cars. I mean,
yeah,
I know a lot of like the bigger events that used to be in person where people would fly from all over. I mean, that costs probably millions and millions of dollars, right? That they're saving now. So I can't imagine as a business how you would be upset about not having to spend all that money, right?
Absolutely.
We'll see how things change. Yeah.
From what I hear, Google like employees have like gyms and spas at the office. Yeah. Like, that's all money, you know, that you got to save.
Yep.
Not only that, but also my concern is everybody's return to office, like mental health. You know, you've become accustomed to living at home now and having to make these adjustments, and people have pets, and, you know, there's now different, or kids. They've, you know, a lot of people had kids during the pandemic. So it's going to be very taxing for a lot of people. And you're going to see a lot of disgruntled employees, I would assume, back at the office.
Yeah. I mean, I have a dog and he's super codependent now. He's so needy, and it's, you know, I mean, he used to chill here at least 6 hours a day on his own and be fine.
Yeah.
But now, you know, you step out to go to the grocery store, he's freaking out, but
yeah, exactly.
You can see how they've acclimated to the change as well. But.
Yeah. Yeah. And, you know, myself included, you know, thinking about being away from home now, it's great that I was able to grow my relationship during the pandemic, because a lot of people, I'm assuming, learned some things about their partners during the pandemic that they're probably not happy with, and had some fights and some breakups and whatnot. But I, you know, my wife and I tighter than ever. So being away from home now kind of sucks. Whenever I'm out working, it's like, I want to, you know, I wonder if everything's okay at home and how she's doing. And, you know, so that's going to happen to a lot of people, that, you know, are super attached now to whatever they have going on. So I don't know how we got on this tangent, but,
yeah, that's a good intro right there.
Yeah, man. So if you don't mind me asking, what, you don't have to say specifically a name or anything, but like, what are you doing in the day job?
I work for Adobe.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. So I get to sell like a lot of their creative products and things like that. So it's a company for me that, you know, at least I relate to on, I mean, I used a lot of their products when I was younger, right? You know, Photoshop and Illustrator and things like that. So yeah, it's fun. I have great conversations with a lot of creatives at companies and things like that. So, and it's a very balanced, I think, company in regard to them acknowledging like a live work balance, and they're very accommodating in that manner. So It's been good. Yeah.
That's good to hear. Cause that, I mean, I think of Adobe, I don't know the actual size of the company, but it appears in my brain as a giant corporation only because I've had Photoshop, you know, since I can use a computer. So
they're a good sized company for sure. I mean, it's by far the largest company I've ever worked at, but
that's good to hear. Cause a lot of corporate, you know, workplaces that I've heard just have really, they don't care about their employees cause they could just churn them out. You know, anybody's would be, you know, like for Apple, like anybody would be happy to go work for Apple. You know, they hear the stories, but I guess like once you get there, you know, it's a little different.
Yeah, I've heard I've known a few people who have worked there, and some people love it. Others said it's exactly what you're saying. It's just like a, you know, sweatshop and but I'm sure that varies depending on what your role is there and the department and all that. But
yeah.
Overall, yeah. I mean, I'm sure, you know, Apple's got a lot of that, you know, music foundation, kind of creative aspect. I mean, creatives use Macs and things like that. So I don't know. That's like where I relate to Adobe, is that it's kind of foundation and art. And they're so involved in cinema and music and all these things, right? And so there's a lot to kind of connect to, if you will.
Absolutely, man. And, you know, I wouldn't be where I am today without them. And I'm not getting paid for this. I'm just saying, like, I, you know, Photoshop and Illustrator have really defined a lot of my career in terms of the podcast or the band, you know, all my band's artwork I did on Photoshop, just mixing pictures and whatnot and making stuff happen with like a one of those. What did I forget they're called? With the pens.
Stylus or whatever.
Stylus, yeah. So, I mean, it's great. And I'm happy to hear that I've been using and supporting a company that cares about their employees. So
yeah. Overall, it's been good. Yeah,
that's good. So musically for you, last time we spoke, you had mentioned that you guys were, you know, dabbling on a new album.
Mm-hmm.
How did that go? How is it going? I know that there's been teases on the social medias that I've been seeing. So how is that going?
Yeah, it's going well. I mean, obviously we're actually on a really good roll of meeting. I mean, at least probably 3 days a week.
Nice.
And you know, that was kind of pre COVID and all that. And obviously with this getting in the way, it changed things up a little bit. I've been meeting with Mark and Drew pretty much every week. Usually we meet up on Tuesdays because Mark, he's living in Sacramento now and he does some work in the Bay Area still. So when he's here, we meet up. And so we've been productive. It's been consistent. We have a lot of material. I mean, probably two albums worth, to be honest, if they were in their complete form, and they're not all there, but kind of from a song idea and just a, you know, conceptually, I mean, there's a lot of material, hours and hours and hours. So, it's really just a matter of getting us all back in the room and just fine tuning what we have, working through the kinks, structuring things, you know, probably writing some additional pieces, all those things that, you know, were in preparation for, you know, pre-production and all those things where eventually they're tweaked again and, you know, all the way up until we record. But I think, you know, the goal is to have something out next year. And I know we keep saying that, but it's just, you know, we want to do it right, and we're taking our time, and we're at the age and at, you know, the point of our career where, I mean, the pressure to release it right away outside of, you know, us wanting to get it done. And, you know, I'm sure our fans want to hear it, but we want to do it properly and we're not going to put it out until it's there. So,
yeah, there's no label pressure. Like, nobody's like, you need a deadline. You need a new album next year.
they did say that like 3-4 years ago. And I think they, I think they've given up and now they're just kind of, you know, waiting.
That's good.
But I appreciate their patience in it. I think there's an understanding of where things are at and where we're at in our lives and all that. You know, obviously we're not 22 and able to just meet for 7 hours a day or whatever. A lot of other things going on. But like I said, I mean, I think we're at the point too, like speaking of pressure, where I think we're going to put out a good product because of the lack of influence and lack of pressure from what this needs to be or what it doesn't need to be, right? I think we've kind of reverted back to some of those youthful kind of sessions of just letting it be what it is and just rolling with it and not a lot of, you know, forethought or, you know, preparation of like, okay, we need this type of part or this type of song or whatever, right? And I think we've always been pretty true, but obviously, like, you know, those things creep in and all those outside influences happen from a label to a fan's opinion to a friend's opinion, all, you know, you try to shield it, but it's not always possible, right?
Oh, of course. You absorb whatever information hits you. I mean, whether or not you choose to pay attention to it later, it's not really up to you. It's in there already.
Yeah, right.
it's there. So, that's crazy to hear, though. Two albums. So do you think you want to, like, do a two-parter concept thing where you do one, you know, part one, and then like a few months later you do part two, or do like a double album release, which that doesn't really happen much anymore, as I've seen.
Yeah, not really. I don't know. I guess it's really just dependent on getting the best record together first. Okay. Right.
Yeah.
For me, that's how I picture it. Like, I don't want to think of it as two, but I'm just saying from a material standpoint, we probably could put out two. Okay. The good thing is I think we're going to put out a great record and I think we're going to have a lot of leftover things that are great as well. So our turnaround for the next record, even if it's not a part two, will probably be much quicker. And who knows? I mean, we might record it all at once. It's still kind of up in the air.
Okay.
But conceptually, I don't know. I mean, I think from kind of just a period standpoint, they might be connected in that manner and maybe kind of content wise, just naturally they'll have that gel. But we'll see. Yeah.
Yeah, you guys.
I wish I had a more concrete answer for you, but it's still up in the air, which keeps it exciting, though.
Yeah, and you know, you guys have always I don't know. So this is kind of weird to say, but back in the day, I was searching for more Dredg in my life, and someone sent me a zip file, and it had just like countless demos from you guys. And I'm like, in my brain, I'm like, where the hell did this guy get this? Because like, this has got to be only the stuff that's on their hard drive, that on the band's hard drive. You know what I mean? Just demos of you guys playing in a room somewhere, and versions of songs that are different from what's on the album. You know, different variations of it, more screaming. So I feel like there's still a ton of content that you guys have that somebody sent me in a zip file. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And you've always been that way. You just produce a lot.
Yeah, I think a lot of that is out there, and I don't honestly remember if we just let it, gave it to people or whatever. But even just kind of demo-y things that we did on an 8-track, and there's a lot of random stuff out there. I mean, I actually went back and listened to some of it. It's just kind of a time capsule. I mean, for me, I could kind of put myself back in that year, that point of time and all that, and it's interesting, you know, the things we're doing, and probably, you know, wouldn't be things we'd do now, just, you know, but...
No screaming.
It's good to go back. I'm not going to say that, actually. I mean, I would like to, maybe if it lends itself to it. Yeah.
Okay.
And you know, we started that way. I mean, I used to, when this band started, we just did metal covers, and I was a guitar player, and we had a different singer, four guys. We had a different singer, and I was like guitar, Mark on guitar, Drew on bass, Dino on drums. And so, you know, we're all like kind of metalheads, and that's how we all kind of connected for the most part. I think the yelling, I just wanted to
feel good.
I don't
want
to do it just to do it, right?
Yeah.
And we kind of veered away from that because it was like a lot of the local scene, like a lot of the bands were only screaming and they're all heavy. And I think we just wanted to pull ourselves back from that. And I didn't know what I was. I never thought I'd be a singer. So I just screamed like lyrics Drew wrote back in the day, right? So I slowly just kind of found like, okay, well, maybe I can do more than just scream, and things kind of evolve from there.
Yeah.
I definitely have enough angst to make that happen. I don't want it to feel forced, and I don't know. I think certain songs might lend themselves. We've been writing heavier music, I think. So,
okay. So heavier from your previous work, like,
I would say kind of reverting.
Leaning more into the Etmotif kind of vibe.
Yeah, a little bit. I mean, there's definitely parts that we have, especially from guitar standpoint, that are, you know, more rocking, and even like some of the more mellow like lead stuff Mark's been doing, I mean, is reminiscent of that era. That's kind of what I meant, I guess. Like, you know, we're just being ourselves again, sitting in a room, which is great, and just letting things flow. And you know, Mark's got his other band Black Map, which is kind of on the heavier side, so I'm sure that's kind of influenced some of his playing as well. I mean, it's him, but he's influencing himself in another idea, another band, right? So
that's some next level shit.
Yeah. So we'll see. I mean, there's definitely going to be it's more of a rock album already. It's more of a band driven, like, you know, four guys in a room type of thing. So, but I'm sure we'll have all the elements of, you know, whatever we are, kind of trippiness and things like that, and mellow parts and things like that. It's just
a lot of what,
like,
they
I
call,
said,
what they call the, that you guys used to do a lot, or still, you know, I guess you're still doing, but in El Cielo, there's a lot of like interludes in between the songs that have like sound. What is that? Foley sounds, I guess, almost like you could just hear.
Yeah, Foley. Yeah. Yeah. You know? El Cielo actually had a lot of that, you know, like picking apart, you know, persimmons and doing all kinds of stuff where paintbrushes and things like that, where it gave it a certain Foley ambiance, right? But yeah, I mean, I love that kind of stuff, honestly. Like, even I was thinking just randomly, you know, passing thought. And I've done this in the past where instead of using, you know, a delay pedal or, you know, effects rack, like creating a reverb or creating an effect naturally, right? Like singing through a cone in a tunnel or whatever, right? Like using real sounds to create an effect, right? So I would like to do more of that as well. And I'm, you know, kind of thinking of things I can do with my voice that can change it, but by doing it and using actual tangible things to adjust that, you know. So there's something about that, you know, you feel the realness of it, right? And I think some of that, like you said, Foley, which is kind of a good explanation of it, it puts you in that room, right? Or puts you in that space. So
Yeah, that album specifically, El Cielo, like when you listen to it with like headphones, I have like a movie playing the whole thing, uncontrolled. Like I'm not coming up with ideas. It's just happening, you know? I'm like, ooh. So I just get to lay back and kind of, you know, appreciate the album visually in my head, which is weird because of all the sounds. It kind of guides you. You're kind of following something, you know, throughout the whole thing.
That's interesting. Yeah.
Yeah.
I think, what was it? Tarantino said he writes a lot of his scenes to a song as opposed to adding a song to a scene, right? Like he hears this song and he's like, this play in his head comes out, right? And it influences whatever that vision that he's having based on the audio he's hearing, right? So, and obviously it's worked very well for him. He's a genius, so.
Yeah. His movies are great. I mean, he cares about the music and he cares about the actual full production value of the product that he's putting out. So I like that a lot.
For sure. He cares about the art and making it what he wants it to be. Right. So definitely have a lot of respect for that.
Yeah. Hell yeah. Well, I'm happy to hear that you guys are feeling more yourselves. You feel comfortable, which is what's important, you know, I think at the end of the day for you guys to put something out that represents you and everything that you are and everything that it encompasses, you know, not just whatever a label wants to hear.
Yeah.
And
me wrong. I still have a lot of self-doubt moments of like, should I still be doing this? Like, am I good at this? Was I ever good at it? Right. Like, but that's what helps drive it as well. Right. You got to kind of prove to yourself first that, you know, it is justified and creating is a good thing, right? Because I think that's something, you know, especially working, you know, a normal job or whatever, right? I mean, that's just it still feels like something I'm having to do as opposed to like, this is something that I am, where, you know, music or just even writing alone or whatever, like that's something I want to do. And doesn't mean I do it every second of the day, but it means like naturally it's just something I kind of feel driven by, right? So
absolutely, man. I could tell also into just the way your voice evolved over the albums, you know, because what you sound like in Leitmotif is close to what's on El Cielo, but there's a difference. There's more, you're hitting higher, like you're going for higher notes, like, and even higher in the following album, you know, Catch Without Arms. Like I can tell that you were trying to hit notes that you hadn't done before, and you were not just hitting it, but like blowing out of the water. So I used to do that as well. It was very inspirational for me listening to you guys and the way that you would do that. I'm like, all right, I'm going to push myself on the next album or the next song we write and see how far I can take this, or see if I could try a new sound that I've never done before. Like, so maybe this sounds like it's going to be heavy. All the instrumentation is heavy and you expect to hear a scream. What happens if I don't scream? You know, I mean, and those are all that all came from you guys, for me personally. Like that's what I was going off of.
Oh, nice.
Is that accurate? Would you say like every album you were kind of challenging yourself to see what other, you know, notes you can hit?
Yeah. I mean, definitely. I mean, Leitmotif, we're young kids, right? And I honestly barely knew what I was doing. You know, like I said, I was just a guy who screamed, and then that was kind of my transition into finding out what I could do potentially with my voice. And I can't say that I played guitar for a long time, so I can't say that I never thought I, you know, couldn't sing. I mean, I could hear notes. I knew it as a kid, like I understood pitch and things like that. Not that I'm a flawless singer or anything, but it's, you know, but I didn't know what it was yet, right? I hadn't found my instrument, which was something I always wanted to just be a guitar player. Like singing wasn't like my goal my whole life or anything. But so, yeah, I think Leitmotif was really that kind of foundation or transition point of me kind of discovering what my voice could do. And, you know, it became a little bit more fine tuned in El Cielo. And I think Catch Without Arms was where I kind of really felt confident in what I was doing. And to your point, I mean, it's actually funny because you say I went for higher notes, and I feel like on Catch Without Arms, a lot of my writing was based on how loud we were writing in the room, you know, because my PA sucked. So to get my voice a cut, I would have to sing in a higher register or belt more.
Yeah.
So a lot of that plays an influence, right? And, you know, certain things we would write on our computer, and it's just me and headphones. I don't necessarily wouldn't need to belt. I could just be in the pocket singing and kind of a milder voice, if you will. So all those things play a role in it, but I always want to progress and challenge myself. Right. But I felt like they're all kind of transition pieces into rediscovering what I can and can't do and where I can take it. Right. So.
Absolutely, man. I remember being blown away because I saw you guys with Deftones in Florida out in, I think, St. Petersburg.
Okay.
And I saw you there twice, actually. There was one where you played indoors.
Janice Landing or whatever?
There was Janice Landing, and then there was the State Theater also, I think you guys played there. The State Theater was indoors. But before that was Janice Landings with the Deftones.
Yeah,
I remember having been excited to see you guys, because I was like, oh, I love El Cielo, it's great. And you guys had just started pumping out the stuff for Catch Without Arms. And I think you started the set with Ode to the Sun,
mm-hmm.
which is, it was super intense because it was, you know, you're hitting a register that I had never heard you hit before and consistently throughout like the entire verse, you know, like it was very intense. So I remember just being blown away. I'm like, this is insane that this is happening right now, because it's for me personally as a vocalist, as you know, I also started similar. I bought a guitar, that was the first thing I bought, a Fender like cheap Squire thing for like $150. Yeah. I'm like, yeah, I gotta do Metallica covers, man.
Yeah. Dude, hey, no shame in that.
Yeah. And
Squire, you know, that was like my first. Yeah,
those are the, what was the other one, at the ones that they sell at like Kmart Performance, it's like First Star or something like
oh,
that.
Oh yeah. I know what you're talking about.
They're like a little, yeah, my kits.
I had a Squire. My first guitar is a Yamaha SE110. I still have it. Sounds nice. Terrible, but and it's it's beat to hell, you know. I went through a weird phase like thrashing things, paintings or whatever, but hopefully that comes back soon, because that was a lot of fun. No, but yeah, it's good time, good memories with that stuff, right? I mean, that's was so exciting to learn, you know. Yeah, like you said, like a Metallica riff, right? And
yeah, once you pull it off for the first time, it's always like, what, I did it.
Yeah. Yeah, I would sit in my room all day, like all night, and play, right? It's just so fun. Not that I still don't do that here and there, but.
And now people make tons of money on YouTube doing that exact thing. They just sit there and do covers and like breakdowns of them playing that song, a cover song, and people pay and they make money off of ads and stuff. It's like,
yeah.
All right. I wish I had the, you know, I had that foresight back then, or the technology available, I guess, you know.
Yeah, right.
To make something like that happen. But so guitar, are you feeling that, are you still playing it? Are you writing on it?
Yeah. I play a lot, actually. Okay. I just got a new amp and invested in some new gear and stuff. So I've been playing a lot. My house isn't super big, so, you know, it's kind of a situation where I have to set it up and take it down. I just don't have extra space to like just have a music room. But you know, I play a lot, and I used to, for a long time, I was just playing like acoustic guitar. I have a nylon string, a steel string, and then, invested in some new gear and just, you know, obviously that inspires, right? New pedal or new amp or whatever. So I've been playing a lot more, over the past, I think pandemic really was kind of what, when I think everyone went through that. I was kind of going down the YouTube rabbit hole of gear and just unique pedals and things like that. So
that's cool.
Ended up making some investments in new things since I was sitting at home, and try to make some productive minutes out of the day, you know.
What was the latest, you know, piece of gear you bought? What pedal?
I got a Brunetti amp, which is an Italian amplifier. I got a Novo guitar, which is like a semi hollow body, which I absolutely love. So between those two, I've been playing a lot. The Brunetti's kind of grindy, a little bit more gainy than I normally use a Fender Twin. So I'm looking into maybe even potentially blending those and being able to, like, you know, A/B switch them as well. It just offers a little bit more grindiness, which I wasn't really getting out of the Twin unless you like crank it. So it's been awesome. Yeah.
Are you writing anything you think for, like, when you're in there jamming, is it all Dredge, or are you writing stuff that you're like, this doesn't really fit Dredge, but maybe something else?
Yeah. Something, especially when I was on like acoustic only, I definitely have things, and sometimes they, you know, it happens and they turn into a Dredge piece or whatever. When we're all in a room, you know, like I'll play guitar and I have riffs that I've brought to the table, and we all work kind of democratically and collectively on, you know, it's really just like improvising together. And I don't always have a guitar in my hand. Sometimes I do, sometimes I don't. But I think my main focus generally, I mean, Mark's such an amazing guitarist, and, you know, I I focus on the singing part, but there are times where I feel like additional guitar is needed, or I have a piece that I think is worthy of, you know, working on, and, you know, so definitely contribute on that end as well.
So no thoughts of like possibly a solo album?
I mean, it's crossed my mind. I don't know. You know, if anything, I wouldn't call it a solo record, but maybe like a side thing with another friend or something like that. And like I said, I mean, I have a ton of recordings, just literally terrible recordings on my phone, like internal mic, but I try to log all those ideas. And I usually remember them, right? But it's different when you listen back to them. So
sure. It's pre-pro, is what they call that.
Yeah. Yeah. And honestly, sometimes, I mean, with the compression on the phone or whatever, there's a certain cool feeling about it. Not that I'd want to, you know, do a whole record like that or anything, but
right, yeah.
You could see how, okay, this in a mix could work and actually, you know, be cool.
Yeah. It could be like one of those segues that you guys do too. Like in between, you could hear it coming out of like a speakerphone or something like that, you know?
Yeah. Oh, for sure. Yeah. I've done a lot of just vocal stuff on my phone as well, which I'm like, I don't know if I'll be able to capture that vibe on a really nice microphone or whatever. Right. Mm-hmm. So, and that's happened. We've done that in the past where we just pull like a really poor recording, but it has a certain feeling and it works. Right. So,
yeah, man. So we were talking about Cielo a lot in the segues and whatnot, but I looked it up and it's about to turn 19.
Is it in a few days? Huh? Yeah.
And 20 is around the corner. For some reason, time is flying by, which I guess whatever gets us out of the pandemic faster,
but yeah. try to expedite everything right now. Yeah. Right.
But, you know, 20 is around the corner. Are you guys thinking about anything in terms of releases? You know, a lot of people have been doing like, oh, the 20th anniversary remaster or whatever, something like that.
Yeah, we just did a Leitmotif one, which I believe is up and streaming now finally, because it was not available for a long time. So we had reissue vinyl, and Drew was always great about filming, you know, all of our sessions and just life in general back then, right? So we have hours and hours of footage of Leitmotif and El Cielo, mostly those two. Nice. So we'll probably do something similar as we're doing with Leitmotif now, where we're going to have, you know, reissue vinyl and then a making of, which will probably just be on YouTube or whatever and available for everyone to see. And That's coming out maybe next week or something. So,
okay.
Yeah.
You gotta keep my eyes open up for that. Cause the pandemic really hurt my wallet because I started collecting more vinyl than ever.
Yeah.
And now I'm at like
looking for some like shopping therapy, right?
Yeah. It's like, and you know, sitting here, you know, putting a record on is still something I enjoy doing, like doing nothing else. Just put a record on and lay on the floor. Like it's great. It's meditation for me.
Yeah.
And I only have the Pariah, the Parrot, and the Delusion. That's the only record I have on. Well, and I have a 7-inch of Bug Eyes. Okay. But yeah, I don't have the other ones. So I'm excited to pick and get reissues, because I've been, you know, part of that vinyl collection is me sitting on eBay looking at records that I probably shouldn't be paying that price for.
Yeah.
And you guys, like, the prices are insane sometimes. Like, I saw a record the other day for Turnstile, which they just put out an album. Just came out the other day, and it's on sale on eBay for $1,700. Like, I love music, but no.
Is it like a limited or something? Or why is it so expensive?
Yeah, it's like a 200 pressing or whatever, but
and I guess if someone pays the $1,700, then hey, that's the value to someone, I guess. But I wouldn't spend that kind of money on any vinyl for that.
Dude, and I love music. It's my life. So, and I wouldn't do that. Like, no.
Feel like you're getting gouged, right?
Yeah, it's ridiculous. Like, I mean, the most I paid was, I think, like $250 I paid once for a first pressing of The Fragile from Nine Inch Nails. And it was my birthday. I had extra cash. I'm like, I'm going to give myself a nice birthday gift, and boom, got it, you know, picked it up. But even that, like afterwards, I think it was like 2 months later, they did a reissue of the vinyl.
Of course. Yeah.
Like, great. Now it's $30. Cool.
Yeah. Well, you treated yourself at the time, you know, you got to do that sometimes.
Now I have two copies.
Yeah. There you go.
But yeah, I'm looking forward to getting those on record, man, because those are some that I've been missing. And not just for me, it's just missing. You can't find them in stores.
Yeah.
Those vinyl of those albums do not exist right now. So
yeah,
it's exciting.
Yeah, we're putting out some other stuff too, like a whole, you know, Drew has been working with another friend of ours. We've all been compiling just basically our history from 93 on. So there's going to be a really kind of vault type thing coming out. And, you know, we've
cool.
put a lot of work into that. It's going to be really cool. I mean, I've seen a lot of mock-ups of what it's going to look like, and it's going to be awesome. So for people who enjoy our band still, I mean, I think it will be a special thing for them, you know, that, it's been special for us, right? Kind of relive all these old flyers and just photos and videos and all these things that, you know, you just kind of, they're tucked away for many years, and you kind of relive them when you're, you know, kind of forced to go through it all or whatever. But
let me ask you, are you still into like having physical things? Like, do you get excited about buying like a DVD if it comes out? Because a lot of people these days, they just transition to streaming. Like, everything should be on YouTube or Twitch or whatever. But I still find a value in having some physical, tangible thing in my hands.
Yeah. From a movie standpoint, not really. I've kind of been sucked into the streaming world. I mean, okay. I used to collect DVDs and things like that. But yeah, I mean, now it's just, I understand why people do it. It's just so convenient, right?
Yeah.
Like I said, I don't have a lot of room for a lot of stuff in my house anymore. So
yeah, less wasteful too, like less plastic in the world, I guess.
Yeah, yeah, I think from like a music gear, yes, for sure. I just bought a new bike. Nice. So those little things, you know. But from like a collecting standpoint, I haven't as much. I've actually given a lot of like old toys away and things like that to friends. I don't have any sons, but so I've given it to some friends of mine who have sons who appreciate things like Star Wars and like old He-Man things or whatever, right? Like yeah. I was still holding on to them and, you know,
you checked the prices first. I mean,
I did. Yeah. Yeah. It's crazy. I have like a lot of Garbage Pail Kids and things when I was a kid. And I mean, the prices of those, even I'm like, I should probably just sell this stuff, but
do it, man. Yeah, get it. Yeah. Get it. If you don't have an attachment to it and it's just collecting dust in your house, the older I get, I used to be a big collector. And the older I'm getting, I'm minimizing that, you know, amount mm-hmm. of crap. That's just because if there's like right now I'm in California, and if something happens, if there's an earthquake, there go all my 400 records, because I'm not going to carry that shit to my car. Like, you right. imagine that the building, everything's shaking. Hold on, I got to get this Nine Inch Nails.
Yeah.
You don't think about that. You just run.
Fires or whatever, right?
Yeah.
I mean, yeah. I live in California as well, up north, but it's always, you know, I can see the hills right here. I mean, it's a reality, right?
Yeah. So
I actually read, it's a good pointer, if you do get in that situation where you just have to leave your house immediately and you want to grab clothes, just grab your hamper, because that's like all the clothes you enjoy. Don't pull stuff out of your, you know, closet or whatever, because all the stuff you wear and actually like is usually dirty and, you know, in your hamper. So it's like, just grab that. That's the stuff you like.
Yeah, just don't be gross.
Yeah, and just don't be gross.
There's a lot of bodily fluids that end up in the hamper, so just be careful.
Yeah, that is true. It's a disgusting place, but
hey, it's better than nothing, right? It's better than being naked and afraid. Like
true.
The show, the TV show. I ended up, during the pandemic, I ended up buying one of those go bags. I finally, like, I was like, you know, my whole life I've always been told you should have a bag ready to go. Something happens, you know, just grab it and run. So I finally got one. It's not huge. It's like a backpack, but it's got food and water that's like military grade, so that you could just it could be there for years. The tents and like all the first aid and all this stuff, just kind of like a crank radio that you could just has like a charger for your phone and all kinds of stuff. So
that's great. Yeah,
I finally
there's no shame in being prepared like that. I mean, that is one thing you want to collect dust and hope you never have to use it. But there's definitely a good approach to living.
Yeah, because honestly, like for years, I'm like, well, you know, we'll figure it out. I'm like, well, this is the closest I've ever come to thinking that, all right, well, civilization may collapse.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, where am I going to go get batteries if there's no batteries to get? So,
yeah. You see how fragile it is, right? I mean, it's just on this like crazy fulcrum of uneasiness, and, you know, a little thing or a big thing can, you know, alter it quickly, right? So,
I just got to make sure I don't fall into the other side of the spectrum where I'm just building a vault underground.
Yeah.
And like, you know,
a bunker. Yeah.
I don't think I need to get to that point, but just a bag to, you know.
Bag will do.
A bag. Yeah. I got a knife in there, and I bought a gun, put it in the bag. I'm not going to touch it. You know, like it's just there. Yeah. Just for, you know, Walking Dead scenarios, you know?
Yeah. It seems like more of a reality, you know? So yeah. We'll see. Yeah.
So let me ask you, mental health wise, like, did this all, like, take, you know, was it taxing for you? And how has it affected your writing for the new album? Like, lyrically?
Yeah. I mean, I've handled it pretty well. I mean, I feel like there's, like, this kind of undertone of sadness that I have, though, of, like, just how divisive everything is and how polarized people are. And just, you know, so there's, you know, kind of an element of like that hope for more unity and more understanding and empathy and things like that, where it's really lacking now. You know, and it's easy to maybe say like blame social media or blame this and that, but that's kind of, if anything, magnified what society is, I guess, and given everyone a voice to, you know, express it or whatever, where maybe it only happened, you know, at a dinner party after everyone's drunk, you know, but that's how it feels sometimes. It's like everyone's hammered and, you know, slurring online, you know, speaking in cursive or whatever. Yeah. But, I just, that more than anything has affected me, I think, you know, like it's just, society doesn't feel good right now. I kind of yearn for that, like, innocence of the 90s of just, you know, obviously things weren't perfect or whatever, but it was just a kind of carefree. And maybe that was because of my age, and there's probably someone right now living that way. You know, it's probably, dating myself, but, you know, it's just, I don't feel good about the way things are now. It just doesn't feel collectively as a whole, like we're in a good place. Right. So, I think it has inspired some things for me for sure.
Do you feel that maybe
it's more motivating, I guess?
Yeah, I was going to say, is it inspiring to write, like, now be like, all right, well, maybe use my music to, you know, get yourself out of that situation or try to help people lyrically? Because some of the approaches are off. Like, some people approach it with like talking about how terrible shit is and just kind of, you know, falling into it and making it a dark, sad album. You know what I mean? That's one thing that of culture that I've noticed with the younger generation. Like, my sister is into all this music that she'll bring it up to me, and I'm like, you're listening to something called the Suicide Boys, and all they do is talk about that.
Yeah.
And I've, you know, no disrespect, I haven't heard it, but I just off of the name and the theme, I'm just like, I don't want to, I already have enough of that. Like, why am I listening to Suicide Boys?
Yeah. I've heard it. It's good. I mean, I get it. Why people like it, you know.
All right.
It's one of those things. Like, I don't want to sound like an old man and be like, devil right there. And you know, so I, it's music, right? Like, be edgy, do whatever you want. Like, that's what it's there for. I understand, like, if people are being influenced by it in a negative way, I don't, maybe that's not the best thing, but I think most people can, it's like comedy, right? Like, how are you offended by comedy? Right. Like, let comedy be comedy. These people are here to talk shit and offend, and, you know, let it be what it is. Like, let people laugh off the negativity in life and put a spotlight on the shitty things in life, but kind of make it humorous and say, you know, I have an understanding of this, and we're going to try to create a comical aspect of it. Right. That's how I look at it. I'm not offended easily. By anything. So it's just, you know, there's always going to be assholes in the world, and people are, you know, not good people, but I think the majority of people are great people, and being able to laugh at things is a healthy approach to life. Right.
You grow up listening, like, laughter is the best medicine. Like, we should be paying attention to that.
Yeah. I mean, that's, for me, I that's a big stress relief for me to be able to joke through things. And, you know, even at work, right? It's like a venting thing. You got to kind of make fun of things or talk shit about it a little bit, and then you kind of feel better. It's a vent session, and like, okay, it's not that bad, right? We're able to laugh about it, and that's a good thing. You know,
yeah, we're forgetting. Well, I don't want to say we, because I'm not forgetting that, but you see it on social media and a lot of the news articles that come out of comedians getting, you know, we got to cancel this guy and cancel that guy for saying this. And it's like, guys, I mean, we're forgetting what it's all about, right? Like,
yeah, it's, don't it's, listen to him or her if you're offended by it. Like,
you should have two feelings, either laugh or don't, and walk away. That's it. Yeah. If you don't think it's funny, walk away. But why this, we've gotten, and I, you know, I don't want to get too political or anything, but I think we've, I think the society has gotten this, like, cockiness, this energy of like, yeah, fuck him, I'm gonna ruin his career. Like, it's like people feel entitled to have this power to just shut someone down completely because they disagree with them.
Yeah,
it's weird. Yeah,
not thinking about all the hours and the years and the time and effort that was put into where that person got, and you're just trying to squash it because of a disagreement and opinion or something that was said. Sure, go online and say that's a dumb thing to say, but move on, right? It's very uptight, right? It feels very uptight, and I don't, people need to laugh more. It's a,
yeah, man.
I don't know. It does help. So
the unfollow button is beautiful. You know, just do that. Just use that in your life. You know, just unfollow. Stop.
It's paying attention. You have certain people are your friends, and certain people don't necessarily have to be an enemy, but you don't hang out with them, right? You don't see eye to eye, or there's no, or the differences aren't attractive, or whatever, right? So. Yeah.
Well, it's a lesson I learned in with professional wrestling, and I could give this advice to anyone that feels this way. If you're ever watching something, let's say you're watching the new Dave Chappelle, and you found it offensive, you know what you should do is stop watching it and stop talking about it, because in professional wrestling, they teach you the worst thing is silence. If they're booing you, you're doing your job.
Yeah.
You know, you're making them react. You're making them like, oh, boo, fuck this guy. Like, that's good work.
Yeah.
But when the crowd is quiet, you're dead. Your character, no one cares. They want you to leave. So that is the best protest. Just stop watching it. Stop talking about it. Let them die off if they're gonna, you know, and they're not, because they're going to have their fans. But just let them. Don't let it in your life.
Yeah. And being that person that lets something like that get to you, I mean, that's got to be draining after a while, right? That's
kind of so exhausting.
Like, let it roll off. Like, just, you know, find what makes you happy. Find what makes you laugh. Find a comedian that you enjoy, or whatever, the music. Maybe you don't like the Suicide Boys, but go listen to the Eagles or whatever it is you like, right? Not you specifically, but you know what I mean? Like, you have many more choices than ever, right? And more access to those choices, right? Mm. So it's endless what you can create, and, you know, you can have your own palette of all your likings, and you can ignore the things that you don't like, you know? So,
yeah. With things like YouTube and playlists and whatnot, you can create your own television station. You just put the shows that you like and whatever you're into this one thing. And that's all you watch all day and consume, which is kind of harmful. And to be honest,
I was just going
to
say, honestly, sometimes that algorithm can mess things up too. It puts you in a silo, or, like, you know, an echo chamber sometimes, and that can have harmful effects as well. But
yeah, my wife and I have been noticing on Instagram, they started doing these things called reels. And maybe I sound like an old man talking about it like this, but the reels, though, we both noticed that we were both falling into it, and it was kind of like we didn't want to. We're just, and it's not even like good stuff. It's like, okay, there's somebody dancing. Oh, there's somebody cooking something. There's somebody riding a bike. And then I'm like, stop, put it down. Yeah. Like, let it go.
Yeah.
We're getting sucked into nothing.
Yeah. It's nothing definitely a life sucking. I'm not a big social media guy. I don't really post a lot. Maybe that's part of, I mean, that could be seen as a negative. It's if I'm on tour or something, and you know, we're promoting something, or maybe I want to share, hey, I'm in Detroit and I'm at this rad place, you know, okay, that makes sense. But day to day, I don't have the urge. I don't feel the need to have my opinion out there like that right now either. Like, I'd rather, you know, put that energy into, you know, writing a lyric or singing. And it's like a bumper sticker, right? Like, I don't want a bumper sticker on my car letting you know how I feel about whales or whatever, you know? So, like, yeah. I don't care. I don't think anyone cares enough about my opinion, right? So, got to have a little humility about, you know, your existence. Maybe that would help things a little bit. But
yeah, people need that. That's what's missing. Yeah. No humility.
No, I know, for
and
sure.
And so what we learned from, you know, like I said, I don't want to get political, but the last 4 years, that's what we learned, that you can be entitled and get away with it. You can People need to know. Believe me, you need to know about what I'm thinking. It's like, no, I don't. Nobody needs to know any of that.
Yeah. Yeah. Most people don't care, really, right? I don't. I mean, even my immediate family, they barely care about my opinions. Why would a bunch of other people? So, you know.
Let me ask you about your immediate family real quick. Nothing too personal, but just kind of something that I've noticed that happens to a lot of artists and people that create stuff. Yeah. Is your immediate family, like, do they care about your band?
Well, no, my kids definitely don't. They said it's like only dorks are in bands, or I don't know if to use the word. Probably not dork. I don't think they said dorks, or they said being in a band's cringy or something. I was like,
cringy?
So I pulled up, now I'm drawing a blank on her name. Who's the white zombie bassist? Because I was like, oh, you guys, if you don't want to play guitar, how about bass? That's like guitar, but it won't be something I play, because I feel like because I play guitar, they don't want to do it. Mm-hmm. I'm like, you think this chick is cringy? You think she's a dork? You know, like, this chick's a badass right here. I mean, but no, they don't really care.
Oh, man.
Honestly. Unless sometimes they'll come across something on TikTok and they're like, whoa, your music was on there or something. And then they care for that 15 second snippet. But generally, no. I mean, my mom's been supportive. You know, she always has. And, you know, some of my aunts and uncles, like, they'll go to shows and things. So I can't say everyone in the family doesn't care. Like, they enjoy it. And they've, you know, even in other states where I have family, they'll come out and have fun and whatever. But the kids, not so much. No,
not so much. Yeah, it's crazy. They don't care. My little sister doesn't care about the podcast. Like, I was like really excited about some milestone that I hit, and she was like, what is this? I'm like, I've been doing it for 3 years. But so yeah,
it always reminds me of the there's a great meme of Tom Araya from Slayer, and it's him and his family. It looks like some red carpet thing or whatever. And he's like, yeah, you know, and it's just his daughter off to the right, like rolling her eyes. And I think it says something like, even when your dad's the lead singer of Slayer, like, you know, you're embarrassed or something like that. Right. So that's pretty much it in a nutshell. It's like, I'm still their dad, and I guess it's cringy.
Yeah. I mean, you can't escape that. Dad, stop. You're embarrassing me.
Yeah. Yeah.
So funny.
I don't blame him. I can be embarrassing, actually. So,
No,
they have a point
that.
Sometimes. Yeah.
Well, all right. So the world is reopened, and there are tours in the making, and, you know, some shows are happening here and there. You guys are rounding out these releases, you know, the anniversary and the new album. Is the plan, are you even able at this point with your job and your family situation to go on the road like that and like how you used to?
I mean, probably not like how I used to, but definitely, I mean, we're working on booking some stuff for late 22 overseas. You know, it's just at this point, it's still like a year away, and I'll just tackle it when it comes. Right. But
yeah,
I definitely want to get out there. I don't know if we'll be doing a 6 week run with, you know, 4 days off and then into a 7 week run. And we used to do that stuff, right? I don't even know if I have that in me right now, but it just seems, I mean, it would be fun. Once you're in the groove, it's like anything, right? Like a couple weeks in, I'd be like, okay, I could do this for forever. But right now, just being out of the loop for so long, it seems daunting. But
yeah, you got to do a little, some bands I've noticed that they'll do 3 or 4 dates here, you know, 3 or 4 dates there, like just little jump
around. It's still
around,
a struggle out there right now. It.
Yeah.
Like in regard to ticket sales, and there's a lot of discomfort still. I'm hoping by end of next year, which is kind of our target, like things have leveled out a little bit, or, you know, people have just are forced to kind of go and move along with life and accept that shit, life's scary and got to live though. Right. So, that's the goal. We'll definitely be playing, and obviously we want to have it around something, and hopefully we'll have that record out, you know, middle of next year, maybe something like that, and tour shortly after.
Excellent, man. Yeah, I'm excited for the future of Dredg. I'm excited to get my hands on those reissue vinyls. I'm excited to hear new music. I'm excited to possibly see you guys live. So all I can say is thank you, and keep up the work.
Yeah, I appreciate you having me back on again, and good seeing you.
Good seeing you too, man.
Yeah,
thanks for your time. If anybody wants, so do you guys have an official, that Dredg, there's a Dredg Instagram that I follow, but I don't know if it's you guys officially or if it's
we
fans.
Just started that. We never really had one. We're way behind on that, but.
So is it at Dredg Music? Is that the one?
Dredg the band, I think.
Dredg the band. Yes, it is. Dredg the band.
Mine's not working either. I don't know.
Oh my god, is Instagram down again?
Oh no, now it's coming up. It's really sluggish though.
Did you hear? Before we leave, how did you deal with everything going down for 6 hours? Because a lot of people are losing their minds. I was like,
oh, it was unbearable. One of the worst 6 hours of my life. Now I barely noticed. I was like, shit, they should do this every day, like a little 6 hour siesta.
Yeah.
You know, social media siesta. Like, hey, everyone tune out for a while.
Maybe that's a good solution to the issues that we're dealing with. Like, yeah. 2 hour, 2 hour blackout. You know, in Cuba, they just take away your entire electricity for at 9 o'clock at night.
Yeah.
Like, you should go to bed now.
Yeah. Maybe it'll just be a recommendation. We won't be too tyrannical about it, but let people do what they need to do. But that's right. It didn't really affect me, man. I knew it was down, but it was okay.
I had friends calling me like, what do I do? Was this the Russian hackers? I'm like, yes, it was. They're coming to get you.
It's always the Russians. Look out,
guys. All right, man. Well, thank you so much again.
Of course, yeah.
Thank you for spending time with me, and looking forward to it. I'll hopefully when the tours get announced and stuff, I'll hit you up again so we can like high five.
We can regroup once. You know, I wish I had a lot more concrete answers and, you know, a bunch of stuff to say, hey, this is happening.
You gave me stuff that I didn't know was happening, like all the, you know, anniversaries and compilations and videos and the vault stuff. So I'm excited.
Yeah. And that will be formally announced. Obviously I think Leitmotif stuff has been, or is just about to be. And then the other vault thing will be happening soon as well. So, you know, obviously we'll keep everyone informed, but I'm happy to talk to you whenever, man. So appreciate you having me, and take care.
Take care, man. All right. Cheers.
See ya.
That piece was recorded live at the famous One Second Club in 1944. It was inspired by the clarity of consciousness rather than the vividness of dream, and was the self-proclaimed pinnacle of broken bridges and chest pressure.